a general sense in social scientific work on the future of work that there will be a further decoupling of work in the sense of people doing something and the spaces in which they do so. And in the Corona lockdown, I guess we all experience both the joys and the sorrows of home office. And the expectation is that with more technical solutions, there will be more and more decentralized work. And this may seem like, okay, this is a question for politics and economics, but I just want to point out that this is actually a pretty existential question in a sense, because it can be really connected to deep issues of how you lead your life. And one paper that I found that really drives home this point is that the choice to have children, to have them at all, or how many to have, can actually be influenced by whether or not you have opportunities to work from home. And there was one paper in 2019 that found that in Germany, the broadband internet coverage in different localities had an impact on fertility rates. Not a massive impact, but there was an impact, and it was driven by the fertility rates of highly educated women, I think between 20 and 35 or so. So where we work and how we work has all kinds of implications for what else we do and can do and want to do in our lives. So how can we think about this question of, you know, what are the normative issues about where we work and what this means for us? I want to first delineate the problem a little bit, because there are a couple of other related themes. One is just this with regard to not communing, but commuting, where Jenkins has really written a nice paper recently that some of you might have seen, just with regard to the commute. And there's also some activism on this. There's also a question about access to good work and the distribution of bad work. And some of you might know my PhD student, Frauke Schmode, she's working on that. And then there's the gig economy and gig work as such. For example, Friedemann Bieber and Jakob Modja have written a paper on that and the risk distribution it implies. That's not what I'm interested in. I'm more interested in sort of pretty normal jobs as we know them today, and the question of where they take place. And it's non-ideal in the sense that I'm not asking what would be the best possible solution, but more starting from the here and now and trying to really analyze the nature and the structure of the problem, because it seems to me that there's often a tendency to reduce it to one dimension, whereas in fact, it's really a multidimensional and pretty complex problem once you start thinking about all the different normative issues that are. Can you still hear some noise? But do we still have a connection?
You cut out for a second there, but I'm hearing you fine
okay.
Now.
Okay.
Are we still supposed to be on the slide that says introduction?
Yes, but now okay. I'm moving forward to structure. Do you see this?
Yeah.
Okay, so I'll set up the problem, then I'll talk about various normative criteria one can draw on, and then I'll discuss two directions in which this discussion can go when you really think about policy issues. One is, should there be a right to home office? And that's something that I'm proposing. I haven't actually seen this as an element of public discourse so far, but could there also be something like a right to office? So setting up the problem, I think there are a couple of background assumptions that we can reasonably make when thinking about this problem. One is that our societies are structurally unjust. And I'm here drawing on Iris Marion Young's work just to say, basically, we have all kinds of differences, many of which are unjust. They are not the result of individuals' actions. They cannot really be held responsible for ending up on the privileged or the disadvantaged side of gender, race, socioeconomic background, and lots of other dimensions of where you sit in these structures. And there are at least two dimensions that are particularly salient when you're thinking about these inequalities here. One is whether people have to do care work, because there is this obviously unequal responsibility between genders, typically the disadvantage of women. Also, sometimes the line is more between parents and non-parents, but often gender is then tied to that when you look at just the empirical numbers. And then there are issues about the geography of cities, because often housing in certain neighborhoods is just unaffordable unless you're really privileged. And there's also unequal access to commuting opportunities. Just think about housing prices in a city. And whenever you have a train station that leads to the city center, prices go up in that area in walking distance around that train station. So where you live has a massive impact on how you get to work, how much time it takes you, how much it costs you, and so on. A second background assumption is that I think one can say that in standard cases, there is an imbalance of power between employers and employees to the disadvantage of employees. There are certainly some exceptions, but the standard case is that employees rely more on their jobs than their employers rely on them individually. And in that sense, the employer is always in a better bargaining position. If you talk about highly sought after qualifications, like in tech work or so, then you have some exceptions. But the general picture, I think, is one where it's the employees that, in case of doubt, require more protection from this power imbalance. And in many countries, you don't have any legal rights of voice for workers, such as works councils or co-determination. So that, again, means that they have less power and fewer opportunities to raise their concerns and to protect their interests. Background assumption number three is that there are quite diverse preferences about where people actually want to work or mostly work. Some people really love working at home and others love to be in the office or in whatever place you work in. And I think some of these preferences are really genuine. There is something about personality type, how do you motivate yourself? Are you the kind of person who needs your colleagues around you to really get going? But there are also preferences here that are not genuine in the sense that it's not really about who you are and what kind of personality you have. It's more the result of certain circumstances and conditions in your life. Like, for example, if you have insufficient childcare provision, then parents have a preference for working at home that they might not otherwise have, just because it's easier to balance different obligations. Or, and that's an example that I actually heard from some people during the lockdown, if you have a pretty toxic atmosphere in the office, then it's actually much nicer to only meet your colleagues online and not be in the same room with them. That's a bit sad, but I've heard this from people where the atmosphere was very bad. Thank God I can now work from home and don't have to run into these people in real life. Not a genuine preference, but one that can still be quite strong under these conditions. Fourth background assumption, I think the problems here are the types of problems where we need to look not only at formal structures and individual choices, but also at critical mass effects and social norms. And I was inspired when thinking about this by a paper that many of you probably know by Ingrid Rubens and Anka Gausch on equality promoting parental leave policies, where they also argue, well, there are individual choices and it's hard incentives, but it's also a matter of, okay, is it the normal thing to do? What's the default and so on? And I think that's also true for many of the questions that arise about where people work. So if working in the office is the norm, then those working from home are likely to be disadvantaged in various ways. And Joe also talked about some of these things. They might be not so much included in informal networks, or they might be disadvantaged in getting information before the actual meeting and so on. But on the other hand, if working at home is the norm, then if someone has a preference for working in an office, is what might be seen as the weird outlier. And there could also be pressure the other way, that everyone's expected to work at home, and those who, for whatever reason, don't want to do this are the ones who then have a harder time doing this. So those are the background assumption. And now I'll talk about the normative criteria that I think might be relevant here. And by the way, this is all really work in progress. So if you think I've forgotten some important background assumptions or normative criteria, please tell me later on. The first normative criterion I think that I think matters here is protection from harm and well-being of employees. And of course, there should be workplace protection laws that ensure minimal standards, such as having daylight in your office or having ergonomic chairs, all these things. And I mean, that's not the case in all countries. But for the sake of argument, we can maybe assume that a certain minimum is ensured both at the office, and let's also assume that homes are also meeting minimum standards of safety and so on. But it's quite interesting when you think about the ways in which office buildings are constructed. They assume a certain standardization of what human bodies need. And usually the standard is a young, healthy male body. And that can be quite a problem for people with non-standard bodies. And for example, there were studies that went through the headlines a couple of years ago that the temperatures in office buildings is often set at a point that is comfortable on average, of course, for men, but it's actually too low for many women. There are also all kinds of questions about visible and invisible disabilities and, you know, how hard it is to live with those in the buildings where you're supposed to work. And on the level of social norms, there are also often certain taboos around bodily experiences. And actually, I mean, I'm feeling this right now, mentioning menstruation in a group that is not, you know, not only women, makes me sort of uncomfortable, but I mean, that's part of women's lives, and that should be able, you know, we should be able to talk about these things, but the social norms are still, that's private, don't mention it, and so on. So home office can then be a huge relief for many people who don't have these standardized bodies, because they can accommodate many of these differential needs in different ways. Okay, that's the first normative criterion. Another one is autonomy. So, ceteris paribus, when there are no strong countervailing reasons, individuals should be free to choose where to work. That seems a sort of basic liberal principle. And from that perspective, there's also a lot to be said for home office, in the sense that the degree of flexibility of how you organize your work is usually higher in home office than when you have the typical working day, where you go there at 9 and you leave at 5 and you cannot do something in between. And in lots of offices, this is already a bit more flexible and you can make a phone call for private issues from the office and so on. But from home, you're even more flexible. And there's an interesting source that someone pointed out to me the last time I talked about this topic, namely Simone Weil on factory workers versus small entrepreneurs. And she points out that the small entrepreneurs, I mean, they suffer all kinds of disadvantages and they have high financial risks and so on, but they have a form of autonomy that the factory workers don't have. So that seems to pull in the direction of home office. There is also a question here, and I'm not quite sure what to make of it at this point, whether one should also think about autonomy as a collective value, collective autonomy in teams, for example, and there might be an issue about whether this might actually be functioning better if you are co-present at work. I don't know whether this is true, but it's something I wanted to flag. I still don't have quite a clear view on what to make of it. Then there is non-discrimination, or to put it a bit differently, I think there's a normative criterion not to worsen the situation of those who are already structurally disadvantaged. And in structurally unjust societies, often what you would actually need to really level the playing field would be strategies that are comparable to affirmative action in some sense. So you would want to support certain groups more than others because they have been disadvantaged and need to be helped to be brought up on the same level, as it were. So what you would want to have as a minimum is not to make their situation worse. And again, there are these different lines of gender, or again, anecdotally, maybe the real line here is parent, non-parent when it comes to home office, not quite sure about that. There are issues of racial background and socioeconomic status. Then there is something that I'm still trying to develop, but I think there's also something to be said for the role of workplaces as public spaces. And I'll say more about this below. But what I have in mind here is that workplaces also have a socially integrative function. And I was quite impressed when reading Cynthia Estlund's book on ethnic diversity at work, where she argues that it's precisely the non-voluntary character of work that leads to higher ethnic integration than in many other social spheres where people just voluntarily meet with people who are like them. There's also something which sociologists of work have emphasized a lot, which is the public visibility and the recognition that it means you go to work. There's something about the status of going to work that you lose if you just work from home and nobody knows what you're doing. And I would say this is historically contingent. There is a path dependency behind it and could be very different. But at this point, it's not clear what the alternatives would be if workplaces lost this function as a kind of public space. I'm not saying it's impossible, but at least it's a question that then needs to be answered. And then there is an issue that Joe also already briefly mentioned, which is environmental impact. And it seems quite clear that ceteris paribus, reducing fossil fuel-based commuting is a good thing. But what I'm unsure about, and maybe someone knows about empirical studies on this, I haven't really done a big search so far, but it seems that the empirical effects are not so clear. For very many issues where you had energy saving opportunities in the past, there were always these rebound effects. So one question would be, would there be rebound effects in other ways? Maybe people would drive more in their private lives then. Or there could be an intensification of urban sprawl, because if people don't have to commute so much anymore, maybe they will move out even further, and then more natural landscape gets eaten up by suburbia. And of course, there's also the question of, well, what kinds of transport are actually available? What are their environmental footprints and so on? So I think it's not totally straightforward what the outcomes would be. And I find it a bit hard to really fully integrate this part, because I just don't see how one could get a clear sense of what these empirical effects would really be. But maybe someone has an idea. Okay, so those are the background assumptions and the normative criteria. And what I want to argue and what follows is that, or it's a kind of conjecture, that these normative criteria are quite difficult to combine. So you can't have it all, as it were, at least if one assumes that there need to be rules at a certain level of generality when it comes to these things. So legal rules or rules that hold for all employees in a company or so, it's likely that you need to find some compromise between all these different things that would be nice to have, but you cannot have them all at the same time. But what I think is important to notice is that different dimensions of the problem. And the problems have slightly different structures. And when we are talking about the scenario of a right to home office, I think what we see is a coordination problem that is one of shifting to a better equilibrium. Whereas when we talked about this right to office scenario, it's more a kind of collective action problem of providing a local public good. So let me explain this in more detail. The first scenario, which has been quite common during the corona lockdowns, was as follows. People actually want to work more or mostly from home, but employers are quite hesitant. And what now happened is that corona showed that it's actually quite possible to do quite a few jobs from home, at least in the short run or over a certain period of time. And the question then becomes, well, maybe there should be a political, initiative to change the legal regulation of workplaces and to say there should be a right to home office. And the structure of that problem here is that you would shift to a new equilibrium in which far more work is done from home. And here, one argument that has also been very strong is that there would be potentially environmental benefits. As I said, I'm not quite sure, but in the public debate, that was pushed as, okay, we're going to have these new city structures and people will be much more, locally rooted, less commuting. Yeah, I'm not quite sure what to make of it, but that's what got discussed. And if you think about it in terms of the different normative criteria that I've discussed, it's pretty clear that there could be more autonomy here. You'd have more flexibility for juggling work and life, even though I totally agree with Joe that this distinction is not as neat as it's sometimes made to seem. And there could also be higher well-being for employees with non-standard physical features. So you could have a warmer room on menstruation days, or if you need to measure your blood sugar every 2 hours, you don't get weird looks from colleagues who don't know what you're doing, and all kinds of ways in which, you know, you can accommodate bodily needs much better if you're in the protected sphere of your private home and you're escaping the standardization that you have in offices. And again, I'm very much in the non-ideal scenario here, because in the best of all possible worlds, of course, there wouldn't be these standardizations in workplaces, and some workplaces are not as standardized as others. But I'm assuming that in many workplaces, that's just a reality that we have to face. So people would actually prefer to work at home from that perspective. There are also disadvantages here. One is that there could be new lines of difference or inequality between people, namely who can actually work from home and who cannot. And that was already a big discussion in the corona lockdowns, of course, where you had this distinction between the work that requires physical presence versus office work that can be done from anywhere. And there is, of course, a strong socioeconomic index. Not all physical work is, you know, lowly paid and with bad conditions. Surgeons are certainly quite privileged in many respects. But if you look at the general distribution, lots of forms of office work are the more privileged end of the spectrum, and lots of forms of physical work are the lower end. The question then is, should we sort of prevent this? Should we not add to the privilege of already having a better job by allowing people to spend more work, to spend more time at home and work from there? But I think that those are really different issues, and I don't think they are mutually exclusive, and I don't even think that they are sort of in competition for political attention or something like that, because improving the working conditions for physical work does not have to come at the costs of allowing more flexibility for work where this is possible. So you can do both. You can try to improve the working conditions where people actually need to be present, and you can allow people who don't have to be present to work more from home. That's not really a true contradiction or tension or anything. I think there is a transition problem in the sense that some people have chosen careers that they expected to take place in certain locations, and or they might have not chosen certain careers because they didn't like to work in an office all the time. So there might be issues about, okay, disappointed expectations. Oh, if I had known that I would be able to work from home, I would have chosen that other job. And there could be some, yeah, temporary issues about changing from one equilibrium to a different one. And there are also issues of, you know, how easy or difficult is it for people to switch careers if they prefer to be in one where they can work more from home. But I think those can actually be addressed, and I don't think they are a fundamental objection to saying that we should use these opportunities for people to work more from home. But there are other disadvantages. And one issue is that a right to home office might be used more by disadvantaged groups who might then suffer in the long run. So there's, again, this issue of women in care work, or parents in care work, or care work of, you know, for other family members and so on. There is also the issue of individuals living in the peripheries of cities, avoiding longer commutes. But those would, again, be disadvantaged people, at least on average. And they could suffer quite massive career disadvantages. And what I'm thinking about here is the analogy with part-time work. Part-time work is, in a way, structurally similar in the sense that it allows for better juggling of work and life. But it often comes at the cost of having a really successful career, because you are excluded from important meetings and people don't share information with you and so on. And that, of course, would be a real risk for all the other efforts that are being made in order to improve equality of opportunity at work. It could be counteracted by other measures, both on the societal level, so provide better childcare, improve public transport, and on the organizational level. So you could have a culture of inclusion where everyone gets the information no matter where they work and so on. We really make sure that there is no pre-meetings behind closed doors where people already decide things. But, and here is one of these tensions that I mentioned earlier, that could actually require reducing the autonomy of other group members. So you would have to have shared norms of who's present, who's absent, at what times, and you couldn't just let this be a kind of self-regulating spontaneous process, because then it would very likely come at the cost of certain disadvantaged groups. So you would have to really think about, okay, how are we going to do this together in ways that will not put certain people at a disadvantage? When you think about weighing these different advantages and disadvantages, I think that it's a pretty context-sensitive issue. And it really depends on, okay, how important is it that you're present? Is it okay to be there one day, 3 days? For what elements or dimensions of the work do you have to be there or not? And I think it's really very important that when thinking about this new equilibrium in which we might end up, that there is enough attention paid to those who might be disadvantaged. And I think the best approach for these types of problems is very often not to have one general framework, one size fits all, but to proceduralize the decisions such that those who are actually concerned, whose interests are at stake, can make decisions about their local situation, but on an equal footing. So give workers more voice, and maybe also have special representatives for those potentially disadvantaged groups in those discussions of how you're going to find this new equilibrium where maybe, you know, there are 3 office days and 2 days of working from home, but in ways that really work for everyone. So here, to find this new equilibrium, proceduralize the decision making. Then there's the other scenario, which is the right to office. And here, it's a slightly different situation, but also one that I've already seen in public discourse in various countries. Namely, companies want to save office space, and they want to let every employee only come in, say, one day a week or so. You don't get your own desk or your own office any longer. It's just open floor offices, and you have your bag and your laptop, and you just come and sit there. And if you do this for every employee just once a week, then of course you can massively save office space, which the companies like, which could also have potentially environmental benefits, not sure. But then the question is that actually a good idea, or what could be at stake here? And should there maybe be a right to work in an office? If you have a space at home and the right furniture, then working from home is actually a good idea, but lots of people don't have this. There you would have to think about, okay, what's the distribution of financial burdens? Maybe you would want to give people higher pay, because in fact they are then using their home as the office for the company. So doesn't that justify at least slightly higher pay? So those savings on office space, do they just go to the company, or do employees also benefit? So that's a question how this would play out. But there is also a certain risk of too much home office that this right of office could maybe counteract, which is the loss of the workplace as the socially integrative space. And as I said, this is historically contingent. There could be other ways in which societies could have meeting spaces for people from different walks of life, religious places, neighborhood associations, sport clubs, music, whatever. But the question is, would we be able to provide these new spaces at the same speed at which workplaces lose this function in this scenario? And maybe we would need some kind of, you know, transition period where workplaces keep this function for a bit longer while other spaces are built up. But in any case, it seems that there is a question there about how this would happen, who would pay for it, who would have a say over these spaces. And how well would they actually deliver this function? And I'm, of course, not saying that workplaces are perfect in providing this function. Lots of people say they are far too hierarchical and so on. But we should ask the question, okay, what would replace it? So this, I think, is a collective action problem in the sense that workplaces are local public goods for the people involved. And they might potentially also have spillovers beyond just this local public good towards a broader public good. One dimension here is that you're encountering individuals from different backgrounds. As I mentioned earlier, there's Estlund's research on that. There might also be something about a shared sense of working together that can be a dimension of meaningfulness that you better experience when working physically together. I mean, just think about how sad it was when you had department parties online, or when, you know, someone in your department got a prize and you celebrate online together. It's just totally weird and not at all the same thing as just having a party or something. So there might also be a loss of meaning of, you know, what is it about your work that motivates you, that, you know, ties you together with others, that you really only get if you have spaces where you can be together. And there might also be better opportunities for building solidarity for defending your interests in labor struggles. Though there is a counter argument here, and that became an issue of discussion when Amazon workers this one Amazon plant in the US where they tried to unionize recently, there was a big discussion about how people would not want to do this at work because of surveillance, because they had cameras everywhere and managers were walking around. So if there's a lot of surveillance at the workplace, then in a way there's probably no loss if that space isn't there for building solidarity and trust between colleagues. Last but not least here, also thinking about this collective action problem, if you have too much exit from the workplace as a shared space, there could also be less pressure to maintain a certain quality of that workplace. You know, if it's just 1/5 of people coming in, do we really need a coffee kitchen? Couldn't it also be turned into some office space? Do we really need to have, you know, a certain, you know, I'm not saying beauty, but, you know, making it a decent space that people enjoy being in if people mostly work from home anyway. Again, this is, of course, difficult to predict on the empirical side, but there could be a risk of sort of giving up the workplace. Although, actually, if they could decide together, people would enjoy having a good, decent workplace. But for each of them, it's just easier to work from home. And in that sense, you get a prisoner's dilemma structure. So if we had an alternative scenario of other public spaces of encounter, and the workplace had a decreased role for social integration, there is this potential of having freer and less hierarchical encounters there, although there might be other lines of hierarchy there. I already said this sort of, these alternatives would actually have to be actively sought and provided, because at the moment, workplaces have kind of, you know, they provide a positive externality. The companies don't intend to provide, but it just so happens that they do. And we need to think about what happens if this doesn't take place any longer. There's the transition question. And I think here, because it's a collective action problem, it's not so much a matter of proceduralizing this, but it's really a matter of having a broader public discussion about, okay, what is the value of workplaces for people? What is the value of other places as public places? Where do citizens meet one another? And again, in these discussions, we need to have an eye on those who are already more disadvantaged or who might be disadvantaged further. So to conclude, I've thought about this for quite a bit now, but I don't see any easy and straightforward solution where I would say, okay, let's just go for that model that's going to, you know, give us all the normative criteria and it's going to be better on all counts. Because of these diverse preferences, because of the collective nature of the goods at stake, and because there are potentially different effects on different groups in society, given that we have all these background injustices. So there are quite complicated questions at the level of the political framework, labor law and other regulations, and at the organizational level when it comes especially to fairness towards disadvantaged groups. That's it from me. I'm still, as you really can see, thinking through these things, and I really look forward to discussing them with you. And I can now stop sharing my screen and I'll finally see you again, I hope. Yeah.
Thanks very much, Lisa. That gave us a ton to think about. Really interesting. So we'll give everybody 5 minutes to stand up and stretch their legs. We'll come back at 15 past the hour for some Q&A. And as always, you can hang out in the meetup space that Alex provided if you're interested. Okay, I'll turn off my camera until then, and I'll see you in 5 minutes. Hi, everybody. Welcome back. So we've got some time now for questions and answers. So if you've got something, if you have a question that you want to put to our speaker, please, by all means, raise your hand and we'll hear what you have to say. Great. And as before, it's a bit late now. If you're an early career scholar, we want to give you priority. We've already got four hands up, and I don't know. So anyway, so please just if you fall into that category, and I think you do, Rebecca, if I'm not wrong. Rebecca, why don't you go first?
Sure. Okay. Thanks so much for your talk. It was really interesting. I was especially interested by the idea, you can hear me, right? Yeah, okay. I was especially interested by the idea that those who choose to work from home, who are more likely to be, say, women, would likely be disadvantaged in the workplace, like relative to those who go into the office. And you mentioned that one way of counteracting that would be at an organizational level through like a culture of inclusion, but that might reduce the autonomy of other groups. So I guess my question is twofold. Firstly, I was wondering if you could expand on how exactly the autonomy of other groups would be reduced. And then secondly, you mentioned that some sort of proceduralist solution might work. But then if you were to have like a one worker, one vote system, for instance, then minority groups like women in corporations might be outvoted. So I know you mentioned things about representatives as well, but I guess I was also wondering if you could expand on that. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, maybe I have too negative a view of things here, but I mean, I've heard many, many stories of, you know, part-time workers, and those are often women in many countries, being kept out of all these informal channels and networks where decisions are made, or, you know, you hear about some projects that will be done early on, and then if you know about it already, you can build an argument for why you deserve to get the best of them, and the other projects have to be distributed to other people. So that's the kind of informal mechanisms that I have in mind. And I mean, of course, by saying the autonomy of other groups might have to be reduced, I'm not saying that this shouldn't happen. It's just, you know, that there would have to be some either self-imposed moral restraints, but hopefully also some social norms. I doubt that you would be very successful with formal norms, because formally all these mechanisms are not supposed to happen anyway. So it would have to happen on a different level. But it would mean that certain more privileged members of, say, that team could not do anything they wanted. They would have to say, okay, no, I'm not going to share that information till everyone's in the room and we have a fair process. And that would probably be the right thing to do anyway. But that's, again, often not quite what we see. And you're right. I think one person, one vote can, I mean, it would probably be better than what we have in many workplaces, but it would potentially create risks for minorities. Although, I mean, you even have workplaces where it's actually a majority of people who are in a certain have a certain structural disadvantage, and the few others have all the power because they don't have that structural disadvantage. But what I was thinking of was, I mean, again, the empirical examples that I know of don't work terribly well, but it probably could be done better, like having a women's officer or a parents officer, if parenting is actually the thing here, maybe both. To really make sure that you don't end up with solutions that may not even have been intended, you know, to discriminate anyone, but that would, yeah, come at the cost of certain people. And it's very likely that, you know, if you have one person who is sort of the spokesperson for that group, he or she could also get all the information about what the effects are actually going to be on people, because sometimes people might not even dare to speak openly about, okay, I'm pretty sure this or that will happen, but I'm too shy, or I feel like it won't make a difference anyway, so I'm not going to even say it beforehand. And then the decision is taken, and then afterwards people say, well, yeah, of course, I knew this would happen. And then you think, well, why didn't you say it? But there are often good reasons for employees not to say certain things at work. But if you had a representative, then there could be sort of a channeling of information about possible effects, maybe, you know, even keep it anonymous. And then these things could be brought to the table. The cynic in me says that there's also a risk that person would then just not be taken very seriously. So again, it's just having the formal institutions in place is not going to do the trick, because others then need to be willing to actually hear that person out and take seriously what he or she has to say. But it could, I think it could be a good step to at least increase the likelihood that the interests and perspectives of more disadvantaged employees would be taken into account. Does that clarify what I was thinking about?
Yeah, no, that definitely helps. Yeah, thanks.
All right, we'll move on next to Benjamin Mullins.
Hi, thanks for your talk. So, two comments loosely. So the first point is that, so if you take the right to work from home, and it seems to me like even if you take all of the disadvantages, it still seems like there should be a right to work from home if you have a right to work from the office, right? And vice versa. So the question, or what seems to me is like, shouldn't you have both of these rights? And then the best way is how do we kind of incorporate both of them? And then the second point is just a point for the analysis. A lot of the debate in the UK, at least in England, and the English Conservative Party, they didn't want to have this kind of right to work from home because of the economy that the workers brought to the office. So what Joe talked about, kind of like the pubs being full, they wanted everyone to come back to the office because that looks good for the economy, right? And then that looks good for the party and so on. Cheers.
Thank you. Yeah, no, that latter point is really interesting. I mean, why can't people drink at pubs in their neighborhoods? Why does it have to be the pubs in near their offices? That's the structures we currently have, and I'm not surprised that the Conservatives are in favor of that. But I mean, it does illustrate again that there are quite a few ripple effects if you really think through, okay, what would it mean if all of us just came to the office once a week or so? When you first said all the other businesses that depend on it, I was also thinking, okay, maybe also transport companies. I mean, insofar as those are private companies, even car companies might fear, okay, maybe people don't need a car any longer. What happens to our sales then? The conservative impulse, I guess, would always not to change anything and just keep it. But that, of course, then doesn't allow us to ask the question, okay, are we actually in a good equilibrium here? And couldn't we have a much better equilibrium if we shifted? And I mean, maybe some of these pub owners would be willing to relocate, who knows? But it's true that there are all these questions about who else would then be affected in what ways. And about having a right to work from home and a right to work from home office, from office, I haven't thought about whether there is any tension or contradiction between them. You're probably right that we should have both, but we would still need certain mechanisms of coordination of who does what, when, what does it mean for how much office space is actually really available. And I mean, you get into all kinds of micro questions. So for example, should there be one day where everyone's in, but then you need space for everyone in the building? From a company perspective, wanting to save space, it's probably better if you distribute people to different days. Maybe you can distribute the different teams or so. So I think I have to think a bit more about it, but I think I would agree that there should be both rights, but that doesn't answer all the questions of how do we coordinate the actual behavior within the space that then gets opened up? Thank you.
Okay, thanks to you both. Next up, let's hear from Simeon Goldstraw.
Hiya, and thank you for the talk. It's really interesting and a lot to think about. I just kind of wanted to press you on one of the normative criteria, which was the workplaces as public spaces. And I confess that I haven't read the book, which was by Estland, was it, that you mentioned? So maybe you can correct me on this. And I'll say also that I do think I definitely buy the idea that commuting and trains and public transport and stuff like that could be a public space. But yeah, I just wondered whether this kind of idea of workplaces as public spaces is really true. And I was sort of had two things in my mind here. So the first thing I was thinking was, well, a lot of offices particularly are quite like homogenous. So, for example, call centers are likely to be made up predominantly of people that are like perhaps lower educated or have fewer qualifications. Office jobs in sort of centers like London are probably sort of like people who are more qualified. And then charities are going to be people that are more left wing, people that work, or finance companies are going to be people that are more right wing. And so, you know, I wondered whether like actually offices are all that diverse. And then I kind of had this also, I wonder whether there's a bit of an analogy here with like public parks. So you'll be aware there's this ideal, right, that like public parks are these wonderful democratic spaces where people meet different people and engage in different ideas. But actually, most public parks kind of aren't that. Most public parks are just places where people go to sort of hang out and to meet their friends, which is a good thing, I think. But like, it isn't a democratic space. So I just wondered whether I wanted to challenge you a bit, and just I wondered whether that, you know, like how much public like offices really are these kind of important public spaces that you kind of like said they might be.
Yeah, thank you. I totally see the point. And I would love to have a different word, because public space is really, and there are different ways in which something can be public or private. And it's definitely not a public space in the sense that like anyone can just wander in or so. I mean, offices are also highly protected spaces in a way. And I also agree that there is some degree of socioeconomic sorting. And I mean, historically, in lots of workplaces, you still had integration across functions, like, you know, the cleaner would work for the same company as the boss, and even the gardener, or, you know, the staff or the canteen, they would all belong to one company. And of course, that's no longer true, because those are all outsourced. So it is true that there is this homogeneity. But there might still be quite a lot of diversity along political lines. It's true. I mean, yeah, you charities and finance are probably extreme cases there, because they are really, you know, you need to have certain background assumptions in place for you to, you know, so it makes sense for you to work in these fields. And those two might be rather incompatible. But in lots of other workplaces, they don't have like an underlying political, yeah, agenda is not quite the right word, but it's more diverse. I mean, lots of people just, you know, they work as office clerks, or they work as scientists in a company or so, and there's nothing super political about it. And then they encounter people who are politically quite different from them. So I think that can still happen. And I mean, the other thing is, and that actually also holds for parks. There, I guess I would also want to say that there's certain value in encountering others, even if you're not directly in conversation with them and sort of meeting them and really directly interacting with them. I mean, this is again a bit the Jane Jacobs point about all the unintended encounters, unplanned, you know, saying hi to someone just because you see them a couple of times a week in the street. All these ways in which you realize, oh, there's a society around me, people do different things, overhearing certain conversations and so on. And I think that has a certain value as well. And a third point is that in a way, it's not only the workspace as in I'm now sitting in my office, it's also the whole process of getting there, having lunch somewhere, going home again, maybe the pub afterwards. And I mean, again, in a better world, there would be much more social encounter between really diverse groups. But if I compare it, the situation of a person who does go out and work in an office that is moderately diverse with a situation of a person who's always, well, just let's say, most of the time, and then just 2 days a week, 2 days a month, those are going to the office, always working from home, meeting people in their private capacity, but not having the steady routine of going to work, I think there is really a loss there. And again, I'm not saying it's something we couldn't do in other ways, but the question is, what would replace it? If these people then all go volunteering in their neighborhoods or so, that would be fantastic. And then I would stop worrying immediately. But can we expect this? That's really the question then.
All right, great. Let's move on to Graham Fairbrother.
Sorry, hi Lisa. I found that extremely interesting. One part in particular you looked at in terms of the workplace as a space, but also compared it to spaces outside the work. And I think you were looking at how in terms of in work, you didn't have a choice of who you interacted with, whereas outside the work, you chose your people who you interacted with. In terms of that, you seem to look at where we are currently and then project where we might go to the future. Have you also, in terms of that, perhaps thought about in the past? Because what we think of as being a workspace, actually, in terms of humanity's existence, quite a short period of time. Even if you take back about 200 years, most women either worked in their own home, in terms of domestic work, or they worked in somebody else's home. High proportion of men were journeymen in terms of moving around or working in farms. So what we currently think of as a workspace isn't necessarily, in terms of ourselves as species, a long-term aspect.
Yeah, thank you. I hope I understood you correctly, because the acoustics were a bit bad. I totally agree that we should not glorify or essentialize the kind of work society that we've seen the last, basically last 100 years, maybe a little bit more. And there have been totally different arrangements of public versus private, home versus work, different gender distribution coming along with it. And maybe some of these are actually such that, you know, when we think about it, we should try to return to them, to some of them, you know, like, for example, communal raising of children in villages seems a much more, you know, both more efficient and more natural and more fun way than the, you know, the wife as a housewife sitting in a separate home in suburbia. So I'm not at all saying that what we had in the last 100 years or so is perfect. That's why I said at the beginning, I'm in very non-ideal territory here. And if you ask me what would be the best possible way of thinking about where to work, when to work, which work should be done by whom, it would be a completely different story. So I'm really thinking more like what's going to happen from where we are now in the next 5 to 10 years or so. But maybe I should emphasize a bit more that there could be really still very different arrangements, and that, I mean, the minimum I would want to say is that as a society, we should really be aware how many other options there are, and we should probably also support people who want to experiment with new and different models, because then we can all learn from, you know, how does it work, where does it lead, and maybe they can then be adopted more widely. That's sort of the broader picture I have in mind here. Does that speak to your question? Okay, thank you.
All right, let's move on to Colin McLean.
Great, thanks for the talk. That was really interesting. Just had a really quick question. Just the background assumption too about the imbalance between employees and employers. I completely take your point with it. I'm just sort of wondering though, if you're looking at this question from a regulatory perspective about sort of should there be like a right to work from home, it would almost seem like what are your thoughts on sort of prioritizing sort of regulators' sort of focus? Like, because it seems to me if that imbalance was corrected, or if we say that we're in an economy where there's say less monopolization, you know, more say smaller businesses, easier to start businesses or something like that, then maybe sort of the bargaining power employees would have would allow them to negotiate these things rather than saying, you know, we need a right to work from home as opposed to. I'm just wondering if you think from a regulatory perspective, is this a symptom of a deeper problem as opposed to a right that needs to be kind of justified? But thank you.
Yeah, I guess I can just say, yes, I agree. I mean, if you had good exit options for people, and, you know, it could be an unconditional basic income, it could be a public job guarantee, it could be, you know, facilitation of starting your own business. There could be all kinds of ways in which the bargaining power of individuals could be strengthened. Although, just as a side note, I think there is a risk of thinking too much in terms of individuals exiting and not thinking about the collective bargaining relations between employees and employers, because realistically speaking, many people will not start their own business, and many people will prefer to work in the private sector instead of getting a public job, because it would probably not be super high wages. So I think that's again part of the non-ideal picture here. And I totally agree that this imbalance needs to be addressed. I mean, I'm all, you know, campaigning for workplace democracy on all kinds of levels and in favor of a public job guarantee. So I totally agree with you. And I think in Germany, we have co-determination, which isn't fully workplace democracy, but there are, you know, in some companies, it works really well in the sense that there is a really good sharing of the power, and if the employees are also a little bit in demand, that helps, but it helps even more if you then also have works councils and co-determination, where they can also make their demands within the normal decision-making structures. And I would love to tell you that those companies are figuring out the best possible ways of doing, you know, the division between home office and working at the office. Unfortunately, and this is sort of undermining my own point a little bit, but I hope it's just one data point. What I recently heard from someone working in one such company was that the unions are now taking care of this, and it's great, but it's getting so bureaucratic that everyone is just, oh my God, this is going to be a nightmare. And there are questions like, should there be a right of the labor inspector to come into people's homes to check whether their workplace is actually ergonomically, if like adjusted so that they don't get back pain and so on. So there are all kinds of interesting follow-up questions, you know, do you have to, and even then tax questions, like if you sort of pay for that office in your own home, you can deduct it in your taxes, but the company would actually, I don't even remember all the details, but it's terribly complicated. And unfortunately, in the German case, because things have, I mean, they have worked well on many levels, but they have also worked for a long time, and there have never been serious efforts to reduce the bureaucracy around it. There is this other side that, yes, they will settle on something, but it will probably be a handbook like this about what you're allowed to do and what not. That's a bit of the downside of really existing co-determination.
Okay, next up we've got Adam Neil, excuse me.
Thank you very much. Really enjoyed the paper presentation. Thanks. I'm working actually like in this area, sort of thinking about these issues at the moment, sort of like relationships at work. And you talk about people working together and sort of like getting meaning from that. But I think there's also the sort of social and interpersonal element of going to work. So I think that people do meet a lot of their sort of social and interpersonal needs through going to the office and through going to work with other people, sort of both from the, you know, water cooler conversations and the sort of workplace social interactions and events. But also, you know, many people meet their friends at work through work. Many people meet their romantic partners. It's like a site where people sort of build connections and then end up with friends and meaningful relationships. And so you responded to another point about, you know, the pubs being full. You know, I was thinking that the pubs being full in the local area, but actually if people don't have sort of friends and romantic partners anyway, because they don't have this site from which to build those connections, then maybe the pubs in the local area also won't be full. And I, if I may, I have sort of like one other point about So you mentioned, you know, office spaces provide better opportunities to build solidarity through labor struggles. I agree with that. And you talk about countervailing effect of workplace surveillance. So that might not always be the case. But again, I feel that if people aren't building these connections at work, they're just working from home, they're not really building these connections, then it's not going to be a fruitful place to build solidarity for labor struggles, even in those, those workplaces where there's high surveillance. Sorry, I rambled on a bit there.
Yeah, thank you. No, I mean, totally. That's what we currently have. And the question is, what could replace this? And I mean, the scenario of having more pubs in neighborhoods would then also require that people actually have a social life there. And that's why the pub then has a function, because you have friends and acquaintances that you'd like to hang out with in the local pub. So it would probably require a bit more than just pubs, but also, yeah, activities. I mean, there's an underlying question here, which I've been thinking about a lot, but have never written about this which is that there's really something specific about working together, which is different from other kinds of social relations. And the relation of being a colleague, I think, is something that in philosophy, I mean, I've never seen any kind of discussion of, you know, what is the specific role of what could be the virtues or the vices of being a colleague. But I think there is something really specific. And also, given how specialized our economy and also the public sector or education, whatever is, often you really need to have a few people around you who understand what you're doing. Otherwise, they cannot really sympathize with you. So a friend of mine who's married, so she's an academic and she's married to a non-academic and her whole family is not working in academia. And she once said to me, oh, I got this other revise and resubmit and I'm so glad I can talk to you because at home, yeah, I can describe to them what it is, but they don't really know what it feels like to, you know, okay, another round of revisions. So there is something about shared experiences, shared successes, shared failures, which I think is rather specific. There is also a deeper question of whether that should be the main way in which we relate to each other in society. I mean, maybe that is actually just, you know, some people will say that's a pathology of capitalism, and maybe, you know, there could be much freer, more spontaneous, whatever, other ways of socializing. But I totally agree that at the moment, the workplace does have this role, and the question then really is, what else would take it? I'm very torn about this argument that Esplund makes, that it's partly this non-voluntary character that brings people together, because it has a bit of a illiberal ring to it. But there is a question of, you know, if people just socialize without any kinds of pressures, would there be stronger sorting just into socially homogeneous groups? And is it a kind of society-wide binding ourselves to the mast, a la Odysseus, to say, okay, there are some sort of structures where you cannot choose who you're interacting with. And that's actually, yeah, you might not like it, but it can actually be a good thing because you meet others that you would not have met in other situations. But it's a phenomenon that we do have at the moment. And so the question then would be, following from that, if workplaces didn't do that, should we have other sort of mandatory ways of bringing people together where they don't choose who they're doing something together with? And how would that work? Would it be feasible? Thank you.
I'm seeing a nodding head. We've got 15 minutes left, which means there might well be time for people who've already asked a question to come in and ask a second one. So put your hand up if you'd like to be that person. For now, though, we'll send it back to El Jefe, Alex Douglas, for his question.
Thanks. I was just going to mention on the thing with the pubs, I guess maybe I'm wrong, but maybe the point of conservatives in the UK supporting this is, you know, very much kind of UK, especially London-based, that basically you have people who are forced to go to the pub because of the reason Joe was talking about. If you live in Zone 4 and you work in Zone 1, you're just miles and miles away from anyone you work with or really anyone you know. So, you know, if that weren't the case, then I think people wouldn't be sort of trapped between the hours of 5 and 8 with no option but to socialise in these paying venues. Anyway, that was just one thought. But I was just thinking, I think the worst job I've ever done by a long way, which I didn't do for very long, was in a food packing facility, because my workplace is a fridge, basically. You're working inside a fridge. Then, you know, the time goes slower when you're cold for some reason, especially indoors and cold, something like that. But, you know, and it's not just the nature of the work. If you were doing, if you're working in a pallet yard or something, you'd be outside doing similar work, and just much better. But all those sorts of jobs in the developed world, I guess, are getting automated away. Something I always think about when people are cynical about automation, I think, well, I mean, I'd rather a robot be doing that than any human being. But so on-site work like that, maybe I'm wrong about this, but, you know, you could think that the trend is that on-site work of all sorts is precisely the kind that can get automated away, because if it's the kind of thing that someone really needs to be on the floor doing it, then it's the kind of thing you can build a robot to do. And increasingly, you know, with internet connections improving, broadband connecting, then, yeah, you know, work that requires humans might increasingly be something that can be done from home. And it's starting to look like an office is a sort of a luxury. This is something you mentioned at the beginning. And I guess I wonder about the politics of it. There'll always be some on-site work, you know, where you have robots doing something, you probably need some humans on-site. And so they're going to be people working in pretty unpleasant environments as a matter of the nature of their work. Might that be a reason to think, well, these things that you're associating with the right to work, these rights to associate, you know, to kind of have these spaces, might it not be better to think about something that we should provide outside? You know, we should entirely divorce from the concept of employment. It's just very hard to make, you know, a working environment as such meet a certain level of, well, to meet any standard, just because, you know, there are some jobs that it's just going to be impossible to make the workplace anything other than,
I think I would agree with a lot here. So take slaughterhouses, for example. I mean, I don't think we should eat animals at all, but lots of people do, and this is not going to go away so soon. So there need to be butchers. And then, I mean, this is a paradigmatic case of really bad work. Lots of them have psychological problems. There is a lot of alcoholism. In many European countries, it's actually done by migrant workers from further in Eastern Europe. So, and at least before Corona, in many countries, it was also, I mean, they had legal constructions of sub companies in order to, you know, evade all regulation and all rules of co-determination whatsoever. Supposed to change now a little bit in Germany. I don't know whether they will really manage. If that work could be done by robots, absolutely. I mean, this is also physically demanding. There are risks of injuries. Also, work in, I mean, this should end for reasons of climate change anyway, but as long as there is still mining work, also, you know, no daylight for hours and hours, high risks for your lung in particular, because you're breathing all this. So I think there is a huge potential to really get rid of bad jobs through automation. The question is, will the processes of automation go in that direction? And that will do, I mean, as long as this is done in markets, it will depend on the costs. And as long as human beings will be cheaper than robots, they will let human beings do it. And I mean, that is another policy task, really, where I think, you know, there needs to be a bit of a, you know, steering the direction of these developments into, you know, the things where replacing human labor is actually most needed, that there would be I think all kinds of arguments of justice, of, you know, whatever. So I'm totally there with you. About the quality of social relations at other kinds of workplaces that are not at the totally, you know, low end of bad work, I'm not so sure whether they cannot be spaces of really positive experience. And I mean, a lot depends on the empirical cases you have. But 2 points. One is that paradoxically, the very fact that you are being exploited together by a bad boss can create such solidarity between people. I'm not saying they should therefore be exploited, but as an empirical observation, you know, suffering together, it does create certain bonds between people that they really value. And they would prefer to build these bonds without the exploitation or the suffering. But even when the work conditions are really bad, this happens. And it's really important for people and meaningful for their identity. The other thing is that there is, of course, an element of interpersonal chemistry, but also ethics about how, you know, how meaningful the social connection that work can be, that no regulation and also no company policy can ever really deal with. I mean, if you have one bad apple in a team, one person who's really either totally, you know, neglects all the tasks and everyone else has to jump in for him or her, or someone who's really toxic, that's something I don't quite know what to think about this from a normative perspective, because on the one hand, you would say other people should have a right to a safe workplace without that kind of toxicity, and they should have a right to sort of experience meaning at work. But then sometimes these are just really weird people who might not even have evil intentions. So would you say, oh, you're not allowed to work with other people any longer? So I mean, there's this level of interpersonal, it's also a matter of luck who happens to be in which team and so, which I think is very difficult to grasp from a sort of perspective of general normative theorizing. You might have, you know, situational judgments about what should happen in particular cases, but I don't think there can be any sort of general rules about what to do about that. And that, in that sense, all that I've said about, okay, experiencing meaning at work, having positive social experiences and so on, that can be undermined by one asshole, excuse my French, in your team. And that's not something that I feel as a philosopher I can say very much about. So that's another challenge here. What I think philosophers should at least try to say more about I've also found it really terribly hard, is sort of organizational culture and social norms and all these sort of seemingly soft factors that are actually sometimes hard as stone. And that can also have a huge impact on behavior and how you experience things. What do you get recognition for? What is frowned upon? And all these things, really important in the everyday experience of working together, but also really difficult to grasp theoretically. I'm not sure I have a clear answer to what you asked. You know, I think it very much depends on the specific context.
Yeah, that's really interesting. Thank you. Yeah.
Okay, great. Next up is Otto Leto, who is giving a talk at this very workshop on Saturday. Just a little plug there. So please take it away, Otto.
Thanks. I won't be giving a talk now, hopefully, but just a short comment question. Going back to the question of the definitions of the public, right? I think that's one of the things that could cause a bit of confusion or question in the ways and that it is used in your presentation. So two phrases that prop to mind. The first one was already discussed, public spaces and what that means, and I'll say just a little bit about that. But the other thing was I think you used the phrase public good as well, where in the context of workplaces, and I wonder if you're using that in the technical sense entailing non-excludability and so on, or are you using it in some other sense? Because I didn't quite fully understand that in what sense it was a public good. And the second is, again, going back to the public space question. I mean, so tying to Estlund's notion of deliberative democracy, of course, raises a very specific notion of a public space as a space of deliberation.
That's actually different Estlund. The one is Cynthia Estlund and the other is...
I see, okay.
Name, David Estlund, I think.
Okay, that's okay. That clarifies things. But it still, I think, raises the question of how public space is defined, and in, you know, to what extent does the meaning of it entail a kind of a ownership structure, participation structure, or is it just a kind of a synonym for a social space? And is there a difference between social space and public space? You know, some private spaces can be social places, and not all social places are public spaces. And so to what extent does the notion of public space entail kind of a vision of a future where kind of there's more democracy, more deliberation in the workplace, in which case they can be truly public spaces, or can we already define the existing workplaces under private corporate ownership as public spaces? Thanks.
Yeah, thank you. I guess I can't quite hide my workplace democracy agenda, and it's always in the background here. Yeah, I mean, there is a vision there, and I would not want the arguments in that paper to depend too much on that, because it is a debate and not everyone is on board with the idea of workplace democracy. And I think people might still be on board with some of the normative criteria I had in this paper. So I try to keep it a bit separate, but it's a totally legitimate question what the vision behind it here is. And I guess sort of the paradigmatic case of a public space would really be one where you have encounters at eye level, no power structures, sort of openness to diversity, all these Habermasian things, if you like, or maybe a little bit of move mixed in, you know, some antagonism can also take place there. And that's, of course, at a huge distance from most workplaces. But I think we should also not underestimate the extent to which people can make spaces their collective homes, in a way, even under very, very dire circumstances, and it might be very unexpected how much people manage to, you know, find opportunities for friendship, for humor, for sometimes also for meanness and mean jokes, but also for encounters that have some of these features that we would consider, you know, the ideal public space. And in that sense, maybe I should use social spaces and not public spaces for what I've been thinking about here. I think this can often, I mean, these social processes can happen without having ownership. They can happen without having a formal say. But if you have ownership and if you have a say, it's probably much more likely. So in that sense, the sort of more ideal theory picture remains one where corporate ownership of work without any voice for employees is just really problematic on so many levels. So I still remain committed to that. But even under these circumstances, I would say there is something that might be lost if we just give up these social spaces without thinking about, okay, what else, where else would we then meet others? And I mean, as someone said very nicely, people meet friends, people meet partners, people have all kinds of social interactions in these places, even though they are capitalist, no non-codetermined corporations very often. So don't throw the baby out with the bathwater, in a way. So don't give something up just because, you know, there could be something better. But if you don't have this better space or place, we should probably be cautious not to throw the workplace out too quickly. Does that speak to your question?
Well, yeah, I mean, we might be out of time, but did you have something to say about the public goods question as well?
Oh, yeah, sorry, I forgot this. Yeah, no, it's totally in the technical sense. It's also probably a bit in a more metaphorical sense, but it is in the sense that it has a sort of non-excludable characteristic, and also once you have nice workplace structures, it doesn't matter whether you have one or a few more participating in it. So in that sense, yes, but local public goods, that's what I meant. So not like society-wide, but there might be these spillovers into the, you know, the broader public good. Maybe I should phrase it more in terms of externalities, positive externalities. But I think the argument can be made that it's a local public good in the technical sense as well. Thank you for reminding me.
Thanks.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Lisa, for your talk and for your answers to the questions.
And thank you for really great questions and comments. That was really helpful.
Let me put in a quick plug. This research network is housed within the Center for Ethics, Philosophy, and Public Affairs, which is a research center at St. Andrews. And that center has its own speaker series called SEPA Talks. And it so happens that Professor Herzog is giving a talk next week. And in the chat, I'm now putting a link to the advertisement for that talk. You're all very welcome to attend. Just get in touch with Alex or me, and we will make sure that you get the link. It's an online talk, so very easy to attend. So that brings us to a close for today. I think we've had a great day one. I hope you all feel the same. And we will hopefully see you again right here at 11 o'clock British time tomorrow for Diana Elena Popescu, Leisure for Everybody, Disability and the 4-Day Work Week. So hope to see you then, and have a good rest of your day.
And pop over to the Gather Town again.
Yes, that too.
Thank you, Ben. Thank you, Lisa.